Welcome to the Sanctuary at TBJ. Tonight's show raises funds that will be distributed to several worthy local charities and nonprofit organizations, including funds for the ongoing care of Gabe Chessman, who is here tonight. This show would not have happened without the support of several people. Ira Berkowitz of Monarch Communications. They developed the Ticket website, and Ira is a board member of the Brotherhood here. David Dandowitz, also a member of this temple, is hosting the website and providing all the ongoing IT support. Thank you, David. Craig Parker, he's the president of TBJ's Brotherhood. Thank you, Craig, for all your marketing support and effort in getting the word out to the show. Todd Kahn, many thanks for co-producing this event together with me. It would not have been the overwhelming success it is without you. We have a full house tonight. You are a loyal and cherished friend. And Rachel, who worked with Todd and myself on the media exposure, thank you also. And my son Jared, he put countless hours into helping with this concert. A special thank you goes to the synagogue's rabbis, Matt Gewertz and Matt Reamer, and the senior staff for their support for the show and providing this magnificent sanctuary for this rock and roll concert. And thanks again goes to all the volunteers for this evening. Many thanks goes to Outpost in the Birds, located in Montclair. They are a nonprofit outreach organization dedicated to building community through music, community service, and cultural programs. Outpost was the model for holding concerts here in the sanctuary at TBJ. They run a concert series throughout the year. Please visit their website at outpostinthebirds.org for a few remaining shows in November and December. They run a great series there. Go see one of their additions. Richie played there a couple of years ago, and Pete is a frequent visitor. He was there last Friday night, and he was there again on Sunday. Additional thanks goes to some corporate sponsors. Investors Bank, our premier corporate sponsor, First Choice Bank, Rand, Fuhr & Klein, Lestrada Restaurant in Millburn, and new agency partners. Hotel Westminster in Livingston has provided lodging for Richie and the band. And a thank you goes out to everyone in attendance for your support as well, making tonight an overwhelming success. Thank you. Most importantly, I acknowledge and thank my wife, Nancy, the most amazing woman in my life. There she is. It's your love that keeps me going, day by day. I think Richie knows what I'm talking about. Every day, I have your never-ending encouragement, inspiration, guidance, and commitment. If you don't already know, we're going to basically have an intermission after Pete's performance. Ladies, restrooms are down the left corridor. Men, restrooms are down the right corridor. During the intermission, Pete will be signing books. So please dig into your wallets and buy one to support his effort tonight. And we also have an electric guitar for sale in a silent auction. The guitar is right outside the rear doors. All proceeds from the guitar purchase go to charity. Richie will personally inscribe and autograph the guitar after the show for the winner and take a photo with you if that's your preference. Pete also will be happy to sign the guitar if you want and take a photo as well. So that auction, the silent auction on the guitar, will end at the end of intermission. And then after the show is over, we'll do the money exchange and the signatures. I am rarely left breathless and overwhelmed, but I am tonight. I have been a Richie Furay fan since age 13, when I heard my older brother playing Pogo's live album, Deliverin'. Pete Fortitel wrote those liner notes in that album. And I'll let Pete perhaps share with you some of his words about Richie's performance and Pogo, what he penned in those liner notes. Richie's music, for me, radiates warmth and comfort. His music shines, illuminates, and enlightens. At time of doubts or disappointments, when I need a shot of inspiration, I listen to Richie's music. Richie has a limitless energy and unbounded onstage joy. His unmistakable voice brings joy to my soul. Richie was one of the early architects of country rock music. So much of what we hear today by contemporary country performers, such as Keith Urban and others, is directly linked to Richie's creativity and style. Music critics were awed by Buffalo Springfield. They were truly the first American supergroup that never was. They didn't stay together long enough. Pogo was loved by critics, but never achieved widespread commercial success. However, they most certainly had a lasting impact as well. Picking up the pieces, the title track on their debut album is considered the first country rock song by much of the music industry. Buffalo Springfield reunited this past year with shows in California and Bonnaroo in Tennessee. Here's what USA had to say about their performance. Stills' high, lonesome voice anchored Rock and Roll Woman, while Young's distinctive cry lit up Burned. But Fiore, who stood center stage, reminded everyone he was the linchpin. His plaintive tone painting songs such as Kind Woman, Do I Have to Come Right Out and Say It, and Sad Memory, with a soulful brush that had women in the largely baby boomer crowd, Do I? Richie, your music is the songbook of my life. Well, many, many years later, after I was just a fan, a bond of friendship was forged with Richie. His personality overflows with joy, kindness, appreciation, and love. I've come to know Richie as being humble and gracious. After he told me the Springfield tour was pushed back until 2012, I called his agent Andy, who worked on putting this tour together with tonight's show. This is the last show on the tour. I couldn't pass up the opportunity to have Richie back for another show. Personal thank you for introducing me to two of my favorite bands, Buffalo Springfield and Pogo. I would turn on Pete's radio show as a teenager and he'd be playing bands that at the time were unknown to me, only to become one of my favorite artists. No one was playing on the radio Backdoor and Rodney, Fool's Gold, Aztec Two-Step. Only Pete was playing bands like that. I'd hear him playing the Beach Boys and Rick Nelson and so many others that you could not hear on any other radio station at that time from any other DJ. Pete played everything Richie. The entire Buffalo Springfield family tree was always in rotation for Pete. There was nowhere else to hear the extended version of Bluebird except on Pete's show on WNEW-FM. Only on Pete's show could someone hear the entire side two of Pogo's second album. He'd play full album sides of any of Richie's music. Pete, you have played the soundtrack to my life. Thank you. Please join me in welcoming to the stage our friend, Pete Fortitel. start by thanking David for letting me know what it would be like to hear my own eulogy. Certainly the right place for it. Let me begin with a question. Why is this night different from all other nights? Let me tell you why. This night is different because tonight a lapsed Catholic is introducing a born-again Christian at a Reformed temple in Short Hills, New Jersey. And isn't that just exactly what makes America so great? Christians and Jews have many things in common. One thing that they have in common is that we like to display our prized artifacts and relics publicly and proudly. So with that in mind, I dug deep and brought one of my own to share with all of you this very special evening that is just now beginning. Here it is. I hope you know the significance of this. A Buffalo Springfield is a steamroller. It's the brand name of an actual steamroller, and this is a sign from an actual Buffalo Springfield steamroller that a friend of mine stole for me 40 years ago so that I could share it with you here tonight. I want to thank David again for that lovely introduction. I have learned over the years that you can't always count on as gracious an introduction as that one, so I always bring along one with me as a safety. Would you like to see that one?
The disc jockeys who are on decidedly different wavelengths, both literally and figuratively, I presume. One is AM, the other one is FM, and that's only begins to tell the story of their different views of the medium. Howard Stern is a jock of Top 40 WNBC, his nickname, How Weird, sums up his kind of free-for-all on-air patter where just about anything goes. On the other hand, there's Pete Fornatel, who's been with the progressive rock radio station WWFM since 1969, and I've known him since that time, too. He's the co-author of Radio in the Television Age. Let's get the from the report from the front lines.
I hate this guy. I hate him.
Do you really?
I could take him in three rounds. I could beat him. I could beat him.
As you can tell, everyone, this is going to be quite an hour. But seriously, folks.
So one of my claims to fame is wrestling Howard Stern on the CBS television network. My friend Tony, my partner in crime with these shows, likes to point out that I'm the one who throws the first pillow punch. That may not be what you may have thought initially, but yes, I did. That is obviously not why I'm here tonight. I'm here tonight to share with you one of the most amazing, unbelievable milestones in rock and roll history. I am here tonight to talk about two guys who released a song back in 1968 when they were both 26 years old called Old Friends. It appeared on an album that I wrote a book about called Bookends, and it contained the following lyric. Can you imagine us years from today sharing a park bench quietly? How terribly strange to be 70. Now in 1968, that line sounded like science fiction. It was so very far off into the future that it didn't even seem worth worrying about. Well, my friends, hold on to your AARP card. I've got mine right here. Paul Simon turned 70 on October 13th, and Art Garfunkel reached that same landmark just last Saturday. Now, how the hell did that happen?
I, for one, have no idea how it happened, but James Taylor has a line of his own that may explain it. The secret of life is enjoying the passage of time. And that's exactly what we're going to try and do here tonight. I wanted to start the party with something really special, something like a brand new Simon and Garfunkel recording or collaboration just for this occasion. And I'm such a heavyweight in the music business, such a mover and shaker. I called Paul, I asked him, he said no. I called Artie, I asked him, he said no. So this is the best we could come up with for something new. I hope you like it. Anybody feeling groovy yet? Pace yourselves, we have a ways to go. When The Sound of Silence became a hit in 1965, I thought it was incredible. I said at that time and have said ever since that Simon and Garfunkel single-handedly raised the IQ of rock and roll by about 10 points. 2 years later, I was teaching English at a Catholic high school on Long Island to avoid the draft. In those days, you could get a deferment with certain occupations. Teaching was one of them. I preferred that to Canadian radio, so I taught school for a couple of years. I walked into class one morning and read the following poem by Edwin Arlington Robinson. Whenever Richard Corey went downtown, we people on the pavement looked at him. He was a gentleman from sole to crown, clean-favored and imperially slim. And he was always quietly arrayed, and he was always human when he talked. But still he fluttered pulses when he said good morning, and he glittered when he walked. And he was rich, yes, richer than a king, and admirably schooled in every grace. In fine, we thought that he was everything to make us wish that we were in his place. So on we worked and waited for the light, and went without the meat and cursed the bread. And Richard Corey, one calm summer night, went home and put a bullet through his head. Now that's a pretty jolting last line for any poem, but the kids never heard it. Their eyes were glazed over, they were slumping down at their desks. I think I heard a snore or two, and it really shook me. I went home that night and I thought about what could I do the next day that would make a difference and light a fire under these kids about poetry. When I walked into class the next morning, I had a record album with me, and I played them the following.
They say that Richard Corey owns one half of his his hometown with political connections to spread his wealth around. Born into society, the banker's only child. He had everything a man could want, power, grace, and style. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty, and I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be richer. Papers print his picture almost everywhere he goes. Richard Corey at the opera, Richard Corey at a show, and the rumor of his parties and the orgies on his yachts. Oh, he surely must be happy with everything he's got. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty, and I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be Richard Gold. He freely gave to charity, he had the common touch, and they were grateful for his patronage, and they thanked him very much. So my mind was filled with wonder when the evening headlines read Richard Corey went home last night and put a bullet through his head. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty, and I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be Richard Corey.
The poetry of rock best exemplified by the Beatles, Bob Dylan, and Simon and Garfunkel. Years later, I discovered that one of the students in that class was a kid named Mike Francesa. You know the name? That's right, the very same Mike Francesa of WFAN Sports Radio 66. And what he says about me to this day is, Fornatown never walked into class with a textbook under his arm. He always walked in with a Simon and Garfunkel album. Guilty as charged, Your Honor. He's right. We all know Simon and Garfunkel as a duo. We know them as solo artists. We've even already seen them as a quartet with the Smothers Brothers, but there was one brief shining moment in time when they were a trio. And here is that moment right now.
To find me a sacred line.
Did you like that as much as I do? Simon and Garfunkel and Williams, who'd have thunk? If you like that, wait till you hear Simon and Garfunkel's version of Moon River.
Thank you, Mother, thank you. Hello, I'm John. I used to play with my partner, Paul.
I'm Paul. I used to play with my partner, Art.
I'm Andy. I used to play with my partner, Claudine.
My God. So this is what Dawn does, is it? For record of the year, Grammys, the winner is... exciting. Oh, two Grammys. I honestly love you, Olivia Newton-John. Producer John Farrar. Very good, very good. Accepting the award for Olivia Newton-John is...
Are you guys getting back together again?
It's terrible, isn't it?
Still writing.
Trying my hand at a little acting on.
Where's Linda? Oh, no, two stuff of that. Oh, are you going to give it in? There you are, my dear.
I accept that on behalf of them, they can't be here, and I'm sure they're very grateful for the honor.
I'm just glad that exists. I hope you are. Now, interestingly enough, what cemented Simon and Garfunkel into mass consciousness wasn't just the hit singles, the hit albums, and the sold-out concerts. It was the movies. In particular, a 1967 Mike Nichols film that captured the imagination of a generation called The Graduate. Now, I know I'm in the minority on this, but I'm one who thinks that The Graduate was way overrated. It just didn't have that much personal influence on me or my life, so I don't really think about it too much. What's the matter? Tony, get that off there. Get it off. Thank you. Oh, how embarrassing. The Graduate isn't the only movie that Simon and Garfunkel's music played a huge part in. The other one came out right at the turn of the century in the year 2000. I wonder how many of you saw it.
What you got on your coat? It's unfair that we can't listen to our music.
It's because it is about drugs and promiscuous sex.
Simon and Garfunkel is poetry.
Yes, it's poetry. It is a poetry of drugs and promiscuous sex, honey. Their own pot.
That's from Cameron Crowe's very autobiographical film, Almost Famous. He started his career, really a good one. Put it on your Netflix list if it's not already there. Very autobiographical. He started his career as a reporter and interviewer for Rolling Stone magazine and then went on to all this tremendous success in film. There's another scene in the film that revolves around a Simon and Garfunkel song, and it's the one from the Bookends album that Stephen Holden of the New York Times wrote the following about. America from the Bookends album was Simon's next major step forward. It is 3.5 minutes of sheer brilliance, whose unforced narrative, alternating precise detail with sweeping observation, evokes the panorama of restless paved America and simultaneously illuminates a drama of shared loneliness on a bus trip with cosmic implications.
This song explains why I'm leaving home to become a stewardess.
We can't talk. We have to listen to rock music.
Cinema that captures the difference between the way we related to our music versus the way the kids relate to their music today in this digital age than that one. Cameron Crowe's Almost Famous. It is said, by the way, that the suitcase full of albums that he as a kid pulls out from under the bed is actually from his own LP record collection. And boy, he didn't miss a one, did he? The first one, Pet Sounds, onto the Stones, and onto Dylan, and onto Joni and Jimmy. Well, he could have put a Poco album in there. But other than that, perfect. Simon and Garfunkel are also enshrined in American literature, and here's where a wonderful coincidence happened because of this show tonight. David told me that a best-selling author friend of his who has written about Simon and Garfunkel lives in Short Hills. And he would have been here himself tonight to read an excerpt from his book, but he has a booking somewhere else that made that impossible. However, he did give us permission to use a recording of him reading the excerpt that we wanted. His name is Alan Zweibel. Alan Zweibel was one of the original writers on Saturday Night Live. His main collaborations were with the late, great Gilda Radner. He co-created two of her most memorable characters, Emily Latella and Roseanne Adana. Linda Fader from Fort Lee, New Jersey. He also co-created the It's Gary Shandling show on cable, but here virtually, if not in the flesh, is Short Hills resident Alan Zweibel reading an excerpt from his novel, The Other Showman.
Just to set this up, this is a novel about a man who is running the New York City Marathon. And as he starts in Staten Island, goes through all the five boroughs, and he has, being a native New Yorker, he has sense memories in each place that he runs through. His name is Showman. and this is what he remembers when he runs through Queens. In the 1960s, certain people were cast as major characters in the ongoing drama that was the daily life of New York City. John Lindsay got to play the handsome mayor, Adam Clayton Powell, the angry guy from Harlem. Gloria Steinem was the smart female role model who was pretty and wore big glasses. Bella Abzug, the smart female role model who was ugly and wore big hats. Nelson Rockefeller was rich, Mickey Mantle was God, Joe Namath was cool, and comedian Alan King said the same things everyone's dad said, except he got to say them on the Ed Sullivan Show. All of them lived in, played in, represented, or joked about New York. But to a kid growing up on Long Island in those days, Simon and Garfunkel were New York. Two friends from Queens. One was short, the other was even shorter. Homegrown and unashamed, feeling set to harmony. Simon wrote them, he and his pal sang them, and an entire generation said that was how they felt too. The Beatles were more fun, and the Stones threw a much better party. But Paul Simon had the uncanny ability to accurately assign lyrics to every one of Schulman's moods. Lyrics that Schulman regarded as poetry, and plagiarized when he was on the verge of failing a poetry writing class in college. All semester long, the ancient professor, a Dr. Nora Katz, who looked as if she had slept with at least two Elizabethans herself, kept dismissing Schulman's poems as incoherent drivel, unworthy of the red ink it took to write, "God, this stinks," at the top of the pages he wrote them on. So he handed in the words to Simon's The Boxer as his final journal entry, confident that the old crone wouldn't recognize the song and have him booted out of school. What he couldn't anticipate, however, was how awed she'd be by Schulman's sudden burst of brilliance. So much so that she insisted he come up and read his masterpiece to the rest of the class. Try as he did to beg off, the teacher ultimately prevailed, and Schulman feared only the worst as he made his way toward the front of the room, the lyrics to The Boxer in hand, with Dr. Nora Katz's enthusiastic "excellent" written in the margin next to them. A quick glance at the time informed him, with 40 minutes left in the period, that there wasn't even a glimmer of hope of his stalling and, in effect, running out the clock. No, it was obvious that nothing shy of an act of God was going to save him from having to recite the words he'd copied from the liner notes on the cover of the biggest selling album of the year. So he cleared his throat, took one last look over at Dr. Nora Katz, was disappointed to see that she was still alive, and began. "I am just a poor boy, though my story's seldom told. I've squandered my resistance for a pocket full of mumbles such as promises. All lies and jest, still a man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest," Schulman said. Holding his breath, he then permitted his gaze to drift upward over the top of the page and out at the kids in the class, some of whom were friends, all of whom were peers with record collections whose jaws had dropped considerably since he started reading. At the same time that Dr. Nora Katz was beaming, prideful of her new find, this young poet whose gritty take of life on city streets that was making her students' jaws drop considerably since he started reading. Her expression also conveyed that she fully expected Schulman to keep reading. "When I left my home and my family, I was no more than a boy. In the company of strangers, in the quiet of the railway station, running scared. Laying low, seeking out the poorer quarters where the ragged people go, looking for the places only they would know." And that's when it happened. To Schulman's supreme horror, it was precisely at this moment that all the other kids in the class started singing, "Why the lie? Fisherman would have been able to identify, much less tie the knot that instantly appeared in Schulman's stomach. A twisted duodenal maze about the size of an avocado pit that would not only rival the diamond as the hardest element known to man, but would make it beg for mercy should the two ever meet in a dark alley. However, the most frightening reaction by far was the one that this musical outburst elicited from his esteemed professor. It's inspiring, isn't it? Said Dr. Dr. Nora Katz, whose fossil-like skeleton was now dipping and swaying and gyrating in what were either rhythmic movements or epilepsy. Either way, once the old lady finally stopped shaking, she gave Shulman an A for Paul Simon's efforts and encouraged him to continue with his writing. Thank you.
That's your Short Hills neighbor, Alan Zwei Bell. We thank him for that, obviously. And we're going to use it everywhere we go. It's not just Short Hills. Everybody assumes that Simon and Garfunkel's main influences as a duo were Don and Phil Everly, the Everly brothers. Not so. I have done massive amounts of research about this. I take great pride in my reputation as a music historian, seeking out truth, never spreading myths or giving misinformation that can't be documented or verified, and such is the case tonight. It was not the Everly brothers who influenced Simon and Garfunkel as a duo, it was these guys. That's my job here. But first, I just want to invite all of you to stop by the merch table to say hello. You can buy a book. You don't have to buy a book. But you know, we're heading into the holidays. Your one-stop shopping can be done right here at TBJ tonight. Unfortunately, the Simon and Garfunkel book is mostly out of print right now. But I have a ton of the Woodstock books in the back of my car. Some of you already have one, I know. If you're buying it for someone for Christmas, I'll sell you one. If you're buying it for Hanukkah, I'll sell you eight. We'll take care of any contingency or possibility, and there is that Woodstock fan in your life that I know would definitely enjoy it. By the way, is there anybody here tonight, I always ask this, who actually was at Max Yazar's farm in 1969? Make some noise. Oh my God. We always get, the least we've had is one. I think we've gotten as many as 12. I think tonight beat the record. Now, here's the other question though. Is there anybody here tonight who thinks they were at Woodstock but weren't? Yeah, that's usually everybody else. So the closest you might come is this, and I'll see you with it a little later on. We've had some fun here tonight, I hope at the expense of Artie and Paul mainly. But I think that I can say with some authority that if you take the Beatles out of the equation, Simon and Garfunkel are the two most beloved and influential musicians to have emerged from that creative musical explosion of the 60s. Yeah. But now it has come to this. With the speed of time traveling faster than we ever could have imagined back then. We're going to take a minute here and pause. This next clip you're going to see has a time code on it. And I didn't even realize this when we were putting it together, but now I see it very differently. I see the numbers on the left side of the screen as the way we think that time passes. And I see the numbers on the right side of the screen as the way that time really has passed in all of our lives. So let's take a minute to wish a happy birthday and many, many, many more for a couple of very special old friends. tonight is one of the memories that you all will choose to preserve. Thank you so much, Short Hills. Just the appetizer, the main course is coming up. Stay with us.
Thank you, Pete. Let's give one round of applause to Pete for the pal. We're going to take a short intermission. Pete's going to be signing books, so go out and buy your Christmas and Hanukkah gifts. We have the guitar outside. It's a silent auction, so if you'd like that personally inscribed guitar by Richie, the band members, Pete, make your bid. We'll announce it right before Richie comes on. And very shortly, we're going to have the Richie Fury Band.